doing experimental testing on aircraft since my Marine Corps days. I was a pilot in the service and a fighter pilot, and fought in World War II after the latter part of World War II and the Korean War conflict. I was at the went up as far as the Yalu River. I didn't start working on flight simulators until about, well, the year was 1954 in September. And, well, a little later than that, actually. Let me go back a little bit. After I got out of the Marine Corps, I took a job with the Air Force at Wright-Patterson, doing experimental flight testing on various different modifications and tech orders that they had incorporated into aircraft, various different aircraft. F-89, back then the B-47, F-102, and those aircraft. Well, I was at Wright-Patterson, of course. I was approached by an individual that, and I'm not going to mention his name, to determine if I wanted to work in an area on just new creative things, okay? And apparently that was the flying disc simulator. What they had done, they had selected several of us, and they reassigned me to a Link Aviation, which was a simulator manufacturer. At that time, they were building what they call the C-11B and F-102 simulator, B-47 simulator, and so forth. And they wanted us to get the experience before we actually started work on the flying disc simulator, which I spent 30-some years working on.
So they had flying disc simulators. To your knowledge, when was the earliest they had them in operation?
I don't think any went in operation until the late or early 60s, around 62 or 63. As I watched, the reason why I'm saying this is because the simulator wasn't actually functional until around 1958, where the simulator was actually operable. The simulator that they used, or the craft that they used to build, which is a 30-meter one, was the one that crashed in Arizona, Kingman, Arizona, back in 53 or 52. I think it was 53. That's the one they used. That's the first one that they took out to the test site. It was a controlled craft, you know, that the aliens wanted to present to our government, or the USA. It landed about 15 miles from, which used to be an Army air base, which is now a defunct Army base. I can't recall the name of it. But that particular craft, there were some problems with, number one, getting it on the flatbed to take it up to Area 51. They couldn't get it across the dam because of the road. It had to be barged across the Colorado River at the time, and then taken up to where people go now, up 93, out to Area 51, which was just being really constructed at the time, and taken down those dirt roads and out to that particular area of the test site. There were four aliens aboard that thing, and those aliens went to Los Alamos for basically, it was a sort of a test thing. They set up the Los Alamos with a particular area for those guys, and they put certain people in there with them, people that were astrophysicists, just general scientists, to ask them questions. The way the story was told to me was there was only one of them that would talk to any of these scientists that they put in the lab with them. only one of the aliens. The rest wouldn't talk to anybody or, you know, even have a conversation with them. You know, first they thought, you know, it was all, you know, ESP or, you know, what do I want to say?
Telepathy?
Mental telepathy. But, you know, most of that is kind of a joke to me because they actually speak, maybe not like we do, but they actually speak and can converse, you know. But there was only one. The difference between this aircraft and this disc and other discs that they had looked at was that it was much simpler design. In the simulator, it was one big thing different. The thing that, like Lazar calls the reactor, okay, we didn't have a reactor. We had a space and a thing that looked like the reactor, but that wasn't the thing we operated the simulator with. We operated with six large capacitors that were charged with a million volts each. Say there were 6 million volts in those capacitors. They're largest capacitors ever built. These particular capacitors, they last for 30 minutes, so you could get in there and actually work the controls and do what you had to get the aircraft or get the simulator, the disc to operate, okay? So it wasn't that simple because we only had 30 minutes, okay? And the reason why it was designed like that photo I showed you was actually when it was operable, it would lift off the ball about a certain amount of there was a dimension there that we had that it actually lifted up and it could actually turn, you know, a certain amount of degrees left to right or whatever. But in a simulator now, you'll notice that there are no seat belts, right? And the same thing with the actual craft, no seat belts. You don't need seat belts. Because when you fly one of these things upside down, there's no upside down like in a regular aircraft. You have your own gravitational field right inside. So if you're flying upside down, to you, you're right side up.
Did you ever get inside the actual craft?
I was in there for a startup, sure.
How do you look out the windows from one of these things with a control?
Actually, we didn't look out any windows. There weren't any windows. The only place we had any visibility at all, and it was done with with cameras or video type things at that time, was in the turret section. My thing was the flight deck. And the instruments on the flight deck, I knew about the gravitational field and what it took to get people to, you know, train them to be able to come in that thing, you know, and operate. You would be sick or disoriented in about 2 minutes after getting in, after it was cranked up. It takes a lot of time because of the area and the smallness of it. Just to raise your hand, it becomes complicated. You have to be trained with your mind, you know, to accept what you're going to actually feel. And
so there's some perceptual distortion.
There's a lot of distortion, yeah.
Yeah.
Seeing, just moving about, it's a... After a while, after you get used to it and all, and you do it, it's simple. You got to know where everything is, you know, and you got to understand what's going to happen to your body. It's no different than, you know, accepting the G-forces, you know, when you're flying a aircraft or coming out of a dive, you know, and that kind of thing. It's a whole new ballgame. Each engineer that had anything to do with the design was part of startup crew. Yeah. You know, verify all their stuff that they put in works like it's supposed to.
Did our flight crews ever take one of these discs out into space?
You know, I don't know that. I don't really know that. I'm sure they have. I'm saying it probably took a while to train enough of the people or sufficient time. The whole big problem with this, with the disc, is that it's so exacting in its design and so forth. And it can't be used, it can't be used as a, like we use aircraft today with dropping bombs and you know, having machine guns, you know, in the wings and that kind of stuff. The design is so exacting that you can't add anything. You can't, it's gotta be just right. There's a big problem in the design of where things are put, where the center of the aircraft is and that type of thing. Even the fact that we raised it 3 feet so the taller guys could get in and stuff, the actual ship was extended back to its original configuration, but actually raised. We had a long period of introduction into meeting, you know, say an EVE, an alien. And I called him J-Rod, of course that's what they called him, but that wasn't his, you know, I don't know if that was his real name or not, but that's the name that the linguist gave him, you know. So he knew J-Rod, you know. And I did draw a sketch of him when he was, before I left of him in a meeting, but, and I provided it to some people, but that was my impression of what I saw.
How much individual contact did you have with him?
Oh, he used to come in with Teller and some of the other guys occasionally on questions that maybe we'd have, you know. But you got to understand that everything was, you know, specific to the group. If it wasn't specific to the group, you couldn't talk about it. Mm-hmm. You know, so
need to know.
Yeah. And you know, he would talk, but he'd sound just like, if you spoke, he'd sound like you. You know, he's like one of the, you know, a parrot, you know, but he'd try and answer your question, you know. A lot of times you'd have a hard time understanding, you know, because if you didn't put it on paper and explain yourself, half the time he couldn't give you a good answer.
When you said there was a long build-up to actually meeting this person, what was the preparation like before you actually had a chance to have personal contact?
Well, the preparation was, going through, first of all, I went to all of the different nationalities in the world, right? Just, you know, these, whatever, you know.
Human nationalities.
Yeah, human nationalities, you know. Then they got into going into other forms of life, you know, even down to, you know, animals and that type of thing. And the fact that, you know, this J-Rod had, his skin was pinkish, but a little bit rough, you know, and that kind of stuff. Not, you know, not horrible looking, you know, or to me he didn't look horrible looking. Some of the guys, you know, that was in the particular groups that I was in, they never even made it, you know, as far as I was concerned. You know, when they gave you the psychological question, you know, I just answered them the way I felt and I had no problem, you know. And that's what they wanted to know, you know, if you'd become, like, you know, hey, here's an alien, he's from here and there, or what, you know, one of those kind of things, you know. But it never bothered me, you know, it didn't amount to much.
So what kind, you know, what kind of scientific advice he would give the crew that was building or back engineering these?
Basically, it was only engineering advice or science advice. You know, say for example, I performed the calculation, and there's a, I spoke of a book that, it's not a book, it's a big assembly of various different divisions of on gravitational technology, okay? And the key element in there, all the information wasn't there, because even our guys, our people that were the top mathematicians and stuff couldn't figure some of this stuff out. So we would take it, and then, you know, we'd have to, with each design, you know, there's a requirement for calculations. And we'd have to prove by calculations, you know, that this thing's going to operate. no different than anything else we do. And sometimes you get into a spot where you try and try and try, and even if you use the formulas to come up with this thing that they'd provide you, it wouldn't work. And that's where he'd come in, you know, to tell him to look at this and see what we did wrong. So you really never knew how many we had. The last 40 years or so, or 60 years, maybe there's, I'd say 40 years anyway, not counting the simulators, I'm talking about actual craft, there's probably maybe two or three dozen various different sizes.
That we've built, or that we have?
That we built.
Okay.
I don't know much about the ones that, you know, that they brought here. I know about that one out of Kingman, but that's about it. And I know the company that hauled it out of there and who's out here now. A couple different versions that they use. One was a chemical version. One was a solid version. And I don't even know the chemistry of the chemical version. But there's one with that operates under chemicals, with certain chemicals. Actually, what they've done with, I think, with these triangles that people have seen is they've got like two or three of, say, a 30-meter crafts that are in the center of it. In the outside perimeter, you know, you could put anything you want as long as these particular ones meet the design criteria and they'll operate. Then it's more or less all that other stuff on the outside is tag along. But I'm sure if they put a large weapon up there and fired it, it would probably, you know, not work. Or they'd kill themselves. There are certain reasons for the secrecy. I could understand that. No different than, you know, the first atomic bomb that they built. But you know, they're getting so far ahead now with aircraft design, and people have come up and they're visualizing and seeing some of the design aspects that are put in some of the aircraft today. And eventually, I'm saying, like I told you gentlemen earlier, that 2003, most of this stuff will be out in everybody's plate to look at. Maybe not the way that everybody expects it, but in some manner they determine appropriate, you know, to show everybody, hey, look at what we got.
So you think, this is the year 2000 that we're doing this interview, so you think within 3 years that the public will be told something?
I said this years ago, 2003. And the reason why I said that, the document I signed ends in 2003.
And you're not the only one that signed?
And I'm not the only one.
It's more integrated.
More integrated, yeah. See, this, I call it FOGIT, or that's what they call it, fundamentals of gravitational, you know, techniques basically. But it's a volume. Now, I'm sure that manual now is just expanded. We're no different than anything else that they build for design criteria, because anything we do today, we have to have a design criteria manual, you know, and they put all the information in that. And if you ever get one of these volumes of these documents, you'd be on top of the world. We'll be right back.